Good morning, and thank you for joining us. I'm Whitney Clavin, a science writer and press officer at Caltech. It's my pleasure to welcome you as we kick off Conversations on the Quantum World. This series is hosted by the Caltech Science Exchange and gives us a chance to hear from scientists and engineers who are working on the cutting edge of quantum research. I'm joined today by John Preskill, a theoretical physicist and director of Caltech's Institute for Quantum Information and Matter, or IQIM. Dr. Preskill originally worked in the field of particle physics, but switched his focus to quantum research about 25 years ago. He is an affiliate of the new Amazon Web Services, or AWS Center for Quantum Computing at Caltech, and he spends his time not only figuring out how to make a quantum computer work, but also researching fundamental questions on the nature of space and time. Dr. Preskill, thanks for being here. And there he is. So
thanks, Whitney. I'm glad to be with you.
Great. So the first question is to help us understand, what is a quantum computer? How does it differ from a normal computer? And what might it look like?
All right. Well, I thought you'd start me off with an easy question. This is actually a pretty hard one to answer, but I'll try. I should begin by saying what a quantum computer is not. It is not just a better, more powerful, faster version of the conventional computers we use now. It processes information in a fundamentally different way using the principles of quantum physics. We've known for a long time, nearly a century, that all matter is governed by quantum theory. And that's led to a lot of new technologies like lasers and magnetic resonance imaging and putting billions of transistors on a chip. But those technologies have really only scratched the surface of how quantum theory has modified our view of what's possible in the universe. And in particular, they don't take into account that when we have many particles that are strongly interacting with one another quantum mechanically, those particles speak a very extravagant language, which is very different from the language that we understand and our computers understand. And if you try to translate that quantum language to ordinary bits that our computers do know about, there's no way to do that succinctly. So if you just have a few hundred particles, if you wanted to describe using bits what those particles are doing, you'd need more bits than the number of atoms in the visible universe. So there's this extravagant complexity, and what we want to do is take advantage of it for speeding up the solutions to some really hard computational problems. I can be a little bit more concrete about it. What quantum theory has done is it's modified our view of probability. Like, let's say I'm watching an electron and I see the electron today and it's at a particular position in space, let's say point A, and I'd like to know, if I look tomorrow, how likely it is to be at a different position, point B. And what quantum theory tells us to do is to consider all the possible paths that electron can take from the first time I looked at it to the second time I looked at it. Where could it have been while I wasn't looking at it? Well, there are lots of possible paths, and each one of those is assigned a number that we call an amplitude. And the theory tells us to add up all those amplitudes to figure out how likely I am to see the electron at position B. But where these amplitudes are different from ordinary probabilities is that they can be either positive or negative. It doesn't make sense to say the probability it's going to rain tomorrow is minus 50%. But the amplitudes can be both positive and negative, and that means when you add them all up, they can nearly cancel one another, the positive ones canceling against the negative ones. And that means you're very unlikely to see the particle at point B, but it's also possible for them to add up to give a big number, and that means it's reasonably likely you'll see the electron at point B. And a quantum computer makes use of a similar principle. There's an input to the computation that we know, there's an output that we can perceive and write down, but in between, we're not watching the computer. And so it's able to follow many different paths from the input to the output, each one of which has an amplitude. And when we add those up, they might nearly cancel one another, and that's an output we're unlikely to see. Or they might add up to give a big number, and that's an output that we're more likely to see. And the art of quantum computing is we want to figure out how to get the amplitudes to add up and give a high probability for the answers we want, the right answers to our computational problem, and to nearly cancel out for the wrong answers. So we don't see those. And the beauty of it is that a classical computer tried to imitate what the quantum computer is doing, it becomes completely intractable because there are too many amplitudes to add up. But the quantum computer can, by comparison, do that effortlessly just by following the laws of quantum physics. So in some cases, we know how to get that trick to work and we can solve some problems much faster than we otherwise would be able to. But there are some problems for which we haven't figured out how to do that.
Well, okay, that leads me to the question. I'm gonna jump ahead a little bit about the hype. You know, everyone thinks that these magical computers are gonna allow you to post to Instagram super fast, or that they're gonna decrypt all our private information. So what are they really gonna do?
Wouldn't it be great if we could post to Instagram really fast? Well, they probably won't do that. And the hype is natural in a way. Everybody understands that computation is important, that it affects our daily lives, that it has economic value. We've seen in recent years a sharp ramping up of interest in the tech industry and from investors in quantum computing. And that's a good thing in some ways. It accelerates progress. It provides opportunities for people to work in the field. But we should be realistic about the timescale for quantum computing having a big practical impact. And we should also, as your question indicates, appreciate that quantum computers probably won't be able to speed up everything we want to do with computers, but only a special class of problems. And we still have only a partial understanding of what those problems are. We'll understand it better when we have quantum computers and can experiment with them and get a better idea of what the important applications are.
And how many years would you predict? How long do we have to wait? 1 year, 10 years, 100 years?
Well, it depends what you want. The status of quantum computing today is we're at an interesting stage. I think we're at a very early stage of the development of quantum computers, but they're still interesting in the sense that we have quantum computers now, which have, say, of order 100 qubits, the quantum analog of a bit. And that doesn't sound like very many, but to simulate with an ordinary computer what those 100 or so qubits are doing is very difficult to do. So we can come up with demonstration problems to illustrate the quantum computer's advantage now. And I think that's kind of a milestone really in physics, that we already have quantum devices that can do things that are very hard for ordinary computers to do, but we haven't seen that impact on practical problems yet. So as far as the time scale, well, even now from a scientific perspective, quantum computers are empowering. They enable us to explore the behavior of complex quantum systems in ways that we've never been able to before. And that will fuel scientific discovery, I think, over the next 5 or 10 years. But for widespread practical impact, I think a reasonable estimate is decades, more than 10 years.
Mm-hmm. Okay, then what applications excite you personally the most for these quantum computers?
Well, remember, I'm a scientist. So I like to think of computers as tools for advancing science, for scientific discovery. And we can use computers to illuminate how nature works in a variety of ways. Sometimes we know what the right equations are with very high confidence, but they're just really hard to solve. And that applies to much of chemistry and the science of materials. we know the equations. They describe how electrons interact with one another electromagnetically and interact with atomic nuclei. But they're just too hard to solve for, say, large molecules or complex materials. They're hard to solve because the particles are speaking in this quantum language that we just can't represent at all succinctly using ordinary bits. And quantum computers will be good for solving problems like that, for studying the behavior of complex quantum systems. That's interesting to scientists, and it'll also have practical impact eventually. Computational chemistry, for example, can facilitate the discovery of new pharmaceuticals and chemical catalysts, and that can have a broad impact on humanity. But it may be a while before we see that impact from such applications. Another way we use computers is to help us discover new laws of physics. And I think quantum computers will be useful for that too. One thing I've been interested in for a long time, as have many scientists, is how should we think about the quantum mechanics of space-time itself? That's important if I want to understand what happens when something falls into a black hole or what was happening very early in the history of the universe. Not necessarily of great practical interest, but a very profound scientific interest. And I think quantum computers will help us to get a better grasp of those things by allowing us to simulate quantum phenomena that would otherwise just be too hard to study.
And doesn't that go back to Richard Feynman and when he thought of quantum computers in the 80s, he has that famous quote about, you know, nature is quantum, and so therefore you need quantum computers. Is that what Richard Feynman was thinking they were going to be used for?
I think so. Yeah, I knew Feynman, and we overlapped on the Caltech faculty for about 5 years between the time I arrived and when he passed away. And we talked a fair amount about science. You know, we had offices on the same corridor. We didn't talk about quantum computing, but we did talk a lot about subnuclear particles and how they behave. That's a case where we think we know the equations. We have a theory called quantum chromodynamics that describes how protons and neutrons and their constituents and so on behave, but as with chemistry, the equations are just too hard to solve. So you can consider something as simple as if you bang two protons together at very high energy, which we do in the Large Hadron Collider, and all that energy gets converted to a big spray of particles as a result of that collision. Although we know the right equations, we can't compute how that process goes from first principles. And that's something a quantum computer would be able to do. So I think part of what aroused Feynman's interest in the possibility of quantum computing is that he realized that with ordinary computers, problems like that would be just too hard to solve. And of course, he also realized that if we could, with quantum computers, simulate how quantum systems behave, that would have other implications, including empowering us to do computations in chemistry and materials that would be out of reach otherwise.
Okay. Now, if you could, so you switched from particle physics to quantum science about 25 years ago. So one question for you is if you could go travel back 25 years to yourself and tell yourself what you've learned now about quantum sciences, like what would surprise you the most?
Well, so what caused me to make that switch was something that Feynman didn't anticipate and came as a big surprise to many of us, which is that quantum computers can speed up solutions, not just to problems that concern the behavior of complex quantum system, but also other things that don't seem to have anything to do with quantum physics, at least on the face of it, like finding the prime factors of large composite integers, which of course is a rather abstruse number theoretic problem, but turns out to be important for modern cryptography. So that excited me because the idea that you could solve problems that would otherwise be infeasible to solve because we can make use of the principles of quantum physics I thought was a really amazing idea. And thinking about that eventually drew me to make quantum computing my major research area. But at that stage in the mid-90s, there was a big challenge we had to face, which is how can we really make large quantum computers work? And the reason that's such a big challenge is because of a phenomenon physicists call decoherence. And it comes from a very fundamental difference between quantum and classical information, that you can't look at a quantum system like a qubit without disturbing it in some uncontrollable way. So you have to somehow, if you're going to do a reliable quantum computation, keep the quantum computer almost perfectly isolated from the outside world. If any information leaks out of it, it's not going to work. And in 1994, when I started to get interested in this field, we didn't yet know how to do that. And it became a focus of the research in our group to understand better how to do what we call quantum error correction to protect a quantum computer from being damaged by its interactions with the environment. And since then, you know, we have understood the principles of quantum error correction, and they're very far reaching. So I think something that probably would have surprised me if you had told me in the mid 1990s is that the idea of quantum error correction, which we developed for the purpose of making quantum computers perform reliably, has implications for quantum gravity, for example. So, you know, I said I was interested in understanding the quantum physics of space-time. There's a sense in which, as we've now understood better, you can think of that as an example of quantum error correction, that there's a kind of robust encoding of the geometry of space-time that makes use of these ideas of quantum error correction, and that helps us understand better the principles of quantum gravity.
Yeah, that is very exciting. Is that what people mean when they say it from qubit?
That's, yes, we have a community of scientists, computer scientists and physicists that are engaged in a collaboration called It From Qubit. And it focuses on understanding how geometry of space-time can emerge from a deeper quantum description. And we've learned quantum error correction is a big part of that story.
That is very cool. Okay, so now we want to ask you a little bit more about your job as a quantum physicist. And what is your day-to-day life like?
I do a lot of email. Science is, particularly theoretical physics, it's kind of a mix of solitary and collaborative activity. So, you know, you spend some of your time reading and thinking and calculating on your own, and some of your time interacting with colleagues and students. Most of the research projects I work on these days are collaborations. So, you know, you discuss problems, and eventually you write up papers together, things like that. The first thing I do in the morning, well, the first thing I do is I look at my Twitter feed, because actually quantum Twitter is pretty interesting. I think Twitter in general has pros and cons, but Twitter helps me feel in touch with the broader quantum community, which I enjoy. But then I also look at the preprint archive. You know, most physicists, when they produce papers, before they've been submitted to journals and peer-reviewed, they make them available to colleagues on an archive of preprints. And so that's where you find out what the news is, and you see what the latest research results are. And so that might steer you towards, you know, reading a paper that day that you didn't anticipate you'd be focusing on when you woke up in the morning.
And would you say there's a creative side to what you do?
Gee, I hope so. I mean, scientists are problem solvers. Well, everybody is, right? I mean, it's part of the human condition, is we all have problems and we want to solve them. And So you have to figure out how to solve problems. You also have to figure out what the problems are that you want to focus on, what questions to ask. And I think both of those things involve flashes of creativity and intuition. If you're working on a problem and it's worthwhile to know what the solution is, if it were easy, probably somebody would have figured it out already. Sometimes, you know, you're stuck, but then you see the light. That may happen because you see a connection between the problem you're currently thinking about and something you thought about before. Those kinds of analogies actually are very helpful. And sometimes it just kind of comes out of nowhere. And sometimes you have to brute force it. You know, you realize you can solve a problem if you just work hard enough and the path is clear, but you have to work out all the details. But it's those creative steps that are the most fun, when you don't really see where the solution is going to come from. And then if you look at it from a different angle, you realize the right way to think about it.
Well, and speaking of looking at things at different angles, that makes me think of trying to understand entanglement. And so when we get into the bizarre stuff like entanglement, where, you know, this particle and this particle somehow are connected across space and time, but not communicating faster than the speed of light, like, does that still make your brain go like, oh my God, like the rest of us? Or do these things intuitively now make sense to you?
I don't think we've used that word up to now, have we, entanglement? But it's a very important word for this whole subject.
Well, maybe start out and define entanglement.
Right. Well, entanglement is the word we use for the characteristic correlations among the parts of a quantum system. And they're quite different from notions of correlation that we're accustomed to in everyday life. You can think about it this way. You can imagine a complex system with many parts. Let's say it's a book. Let's say the book is 100 pages long. And if it's an ordinary book, it's written in bits. You can read the bits on every page. And after you've read 100 pages, one at a time, then you know everything that's in the book. But quantum systems are different. If it's a quantum book and it's written in qubits instead of ordinary bits, and those pages are very highly entangled with one another, then when you look at the pages one at a time, you see just random gibberish, which tells you almost nothing about the information content of the book, although there is a lot of information in it. And the reason is that in the quantum book, the information is not written on the individual pages. It's encoded almost entirely in the correlations among the pages. And so if you want to read this book, you have to interact collectively with many pages at once. So that's the essence of quantum entanglement. And the reason it's so interesting for quantum computing is that describing those correlations among the qubits is very complex. It involves that extravagant quantum language that I described earlier, which we can't easily translate into bits. And entanglement is also the secret of quantum error correction. It's how we envision protecting quantum computers from damage, because we don't want the information to leak to the outside. And the way to prevent it is to store the information in entanglement involving many parts of the computer, so that if some of the qubits fail, those qubits don't know what the information is that the computer is processing, so the information isn't lost. So I don't know if I'd use the word, you know, that I'm shocked by entanglement, but I do find awe-inspiring that it's really because of the phenomenon of entanglement that if we can control quantum systems, we could solve problems that would be infeasible to solve otherwise. And it's because of the phenomenon of entanglement that we can protect quantum systems from damage. And that latter thing is really quite profound because, you know, for physicists of my generation, we're accustomed in our education to thinking about quantum as something that happens for very small systems like elementary particles or atoms. And a quantum computer, though, is going to be a big system, which is going to be profoundly quantum. And so that means we have to have the technology to amplify that quantum strangeness, including the properties of entanglement, to these very big complex systems. And it's a really wonderful thing that we understand in principle how to do it. Now, we still have a lot of work to do to achieve that in practice.
So is that, does that mean that you're saying that it's like the effects of quantum physics we know happen on microscopic scales, but that scientists are trying to make them macroscopic, like at the level of humans, or
is it? Yeah, that's right. Well, maybe not right away at the level of humans, but that's the idea, that normally we don't encounter directly the quantumness of matter. And the reason for that is because of this feature I mentioned earlier, decoherence. It's because the quantumness gets destroyed by uncontrolled interactions with the outside world. And so if we want to amplify the weirdness of quantum theory to human-sized objects or to macroscopic systems, the secret is for that quantum information to be isolated from the environment, and that requires that we encode it in a clever way. And we understand in principle now how to do that. That is, to me, as significant a discovery, you know, which was made in the 1990s, as the discovery that with quantum computers, we can solve problems that we wouldn't be able to solve with conventional computers.
Okay, yeah, that's very cool. All right, well, we're getting close to 11:30, so let's switch to questions. We got a lot of questions lining up here. Let's see, the first one is from Susanna Nieva. Are quantum computers being used anywhere in the world now? What are they made of and what do they look like?
Oh yeah, I dodged your question earlier about what do they look like. Yes, quantum computers exist. They are built and operated both in university laboratories and by tech companies. To solve the really hard problems that we foresee quantum computers will be able to solve, that will require a lot of resources to solve major system engineering problems. And that's going to be done by companies or national laboratories, not in university labs. But at this stage, we have interesting quantum computers, both being developed by university research groups and in companies. There are a number of different approaches to building the hardware. We haven't talked about that yet. And it's important at this stage that there are a number of different approaches being pursued, because we don't really know what in the long run will be the best approach to scaling up quantum computers to the level where they can solve really hard problems that we're interested in. But I can mention some of the hardware approaches. One is to use atoms as qubits. So this is really an amazing thing that, 40 years ago when Feynman was thinking about quantum computers, we didn't have the technology that we have now to control the quantum world with reasonable precision. We can use as our information carriers individual atoms, which we know how to trap with electromagnetic fields, and we can tickle them with lasers to change their state, and we can even get two qubits to interact with one another, a kind of entanglement creating operation, which would be an elementary step in a quantum computer. And there are systems like that with tens of qubits that are operating now, both in commercial enterprises and in university laboratories. Another approach is to make a kind of imitation atom using electrical circuits at very low temperature. Low temperature is good for quantum. It makes the interactions with the environment weaker and makes it easier to see the underlying quantum behavior of matter. And in that case, with the electrical circuits, we can manipulate the states of the qubits with electromagnetic fields, with microwave pulses instead of using lasers, but with roughly comparable performance. Another thing that we're doing now, which has sort of come to the fore in the last couple of years, is holding individual atoms with lasers, using the laser as a kind of tweezers, and then exciting the atoms so that they interact more strongly with one another, so we can process information. As for what they look like, well, you know, the different approaches I described look a little different, but I mean, in the case of a superconducting circuit, it wouldn't look so exciting. It's just a chip with some electrical circuit fabricated on the chip. And increasingly, these implementations that make use of trapped atoms or electrically charged atoms are being made microscopic. We know how to make these traps for the atoms really small, so they don't look like much either. They just look like a little chip. Now, the first computers that really solve problems of practical interest are going to be much larger, we think. Partly because we need to use this trick of quantum error correction, and it has a big cost in terms of the number of additional physical qubits we need. And those will be big systems, and they might occupy a big space, like a data center. And there'll probably be a lot of electrical power just to keep it cold and things like that. So from the outside, it'll look kind of like a data center today, some big facility.
And we've seen the ones that look like a chandelier.
Oh yeah, so those are very pretty pictures. So when you see a picture of a quantum computer, I haven't tried this lately, but if you Google quantum computer, you may well see a photograph of the inside of the refrigerator that's used to keep an electrical circuit very cold. And you know, it looks very nice, but when it's actually operating, it wouldn't be open. That's useful for the photographer, but not so good for protecting the qubits and making them do what they're supposed to do.
Okay. We have two questions from Rhodes Stevenson. Does Caltech have a quantum computer, and how do you program a quantum computer?
Well, at Caltech, there are two different approaches to building quantum computing hardware that are being vigorously pursued on campus. One is the cold electrical circuit approach that I mentioned. And the other is the atoms trapped with tweezers approach. In addition, Caltech has a partnership with Amazon Web Services, which has opened a center for quantum computing on our campus. And there as well, they're pursuing the approach based on very cold electrical circuits. And that's a good partnership, I think, because both sides see the need to focus on the long-term problems. I mean, it's interesting to ask, can we do something practical with the quantum computers we have now or that we're likely to have in the near future? And it's important to find out what the potential applications would be in the near term. To me, it seems most likely that the applications for the next 5 to 10 years will be along the lines that I already suggested, that these will be tools for scientific discovery rather than for solving problems that are of interest in business, for example. To get to the stage where we can have a big practical impact from quantum computing, we're going to have better qubits, we're going to have more qubits, we're going to have to solve some big system engineering problems. And I think we need to focus on that, on those long-term goals. And that's really a good role for the university research groups. Some of the companies are trying to see what they can do now that would help their customers with problems that they want to solve. But in the universities, I think we should have more of a long-term view at solving the really big challenges, which will set the stage for what industry will be able to do, you know, in another 20 years from now. Oh, how do you program it was the other question. Well, actually, there are quantum computers which you can get access to through cloud services. IBM provides one for their hardware, AWS has a service that provides access to some of the hardware vendors, and so does Microsoft. And they have developed software tools which are convenient for defining and executing a quantum algorithm, which you can really run on some of these machines. Like I said, they're small machines at this stage. And so mostly we're trying to benchmark them and figure out how to improve their performance, but nevertheless, they're accessible. And the how you program them is a little bit hardware dependent, but what these cloud services are providing are tools which are more universal. So you should be able to write a program for running on a quantum computer, which can then be compiled for whatever type of hardware you want to try it on.
Okay. Let's go to a question from Joshua Archibald. Will research in quantum computing address the need for a quantum transistor, if I'm saying that right, to keep up with Moore's law?
All right, good question. So of course the question refers to Moore's law, to the observation that the semiconductor technology, which has fueled progress in conventional computing, has resulted in steady progress, essentially doubling our computing power every couple of years. And I guess the question is, will quantum computing take over and achieve the same kind of exponential improvement for some time into the future? Well, we don't really know that for sure, but you know, we can say this, that when we compare with conventional computers, in order to boost the quantum computer's power, we can just add a few qubits, and that can make it a factor of 2 or 4 times harder to simulate what the quantum computer is doing with a conventional computer. So this is one of the remarkable things about quantum computing, at least when we compare it to the computing that we're doing now, that the cost, at least for some purposes, of emulating with a conventional computer what the quantum computer is doing grows exponentially with the number of qubits. Now, of course, we would also like to see the hardware itself advance at a propitious rate, as has been the case for CMOS technology going back for some decades for conventional computers. Whether we'll see that, I don't know. If you compare where we are now to where we were 20 years ago, you could make a case that the technology has improved at an exponential rate, at least by some measures. As far as the transistor, you know, I think you could plausibly state that where we are now is really more like the vacuum tube stage of quantum computers, if we compare with the history of conventional computers. And the transistor, which will enable us to scale up much further, will be an error-corrected device. And that's what we aspire to do over the next 5 or 10 years, to get on the path to a more scalable type of quantum computer that does incorporate error correction and so performs more robustly. And that's one of the things I think we can look forward to in the relatively near term, that we will learn how to do quantum error correction better and actually demonstrate it in real devices.
Okay, now we're gonna move to a more sciencey question, and then I think we'll have time for one more question after that. This one comes from Kunal Muli. Could you say more about how quantum computers could help us resolve open questions about black holes, the early universe, and quantum gravity?
Okay, good question. What has pointed towards a deep connection between quantum computing and the physics of black holes and the early universe is something that actually was developed by the string theorists some time ago, over 20 years ago. The jargon is ADS-CFT duality. ADS stands for anti-de Sitter. It's a type of space-time geometry. CFT stands for conformal field theory. But the important thing to know is that what was discovered was that there are two equivalent ways of describing the same physics, which look completely different. One is the physics of gravity, and the other is the physics of a quantum system that does not involve gravity at all. It sounds kind of crazy, but at least in the right context, it seems to be a true statement that in a room like the one I'm sitting in now, all the information that's in the room, in my brain and in my computer and cell phone and so on, is encoded in some very scrambled form on the boundary of the room, the floor and the ceiling and the walls, scrambled in such a way that it's exceedingly hard to read. And what we started to understand is that the way the geometry in the room, which objects are close to other objects, is encoded on that boundary is in the form of quantum entanglement. So the description of what's happening on the boundary doesn't involve gravity at all. The whole idea of space-time and geometry and distances between things, that's really all a property of the quantum entanglement on that boundary, of that alternative description that doesn't directly involve gravity at all. So in that sense, space-time is a kind of emergent property from a profoundly entangled quantum system. And what I'm envisioning is that by studying the behavior of matter under the right conditions, we can grasp better how geometry can emerge from a deeper description of physical reality.
I'm really excited for that to happen myself. Okay, then let's go to Sonali Sengupta has a question. Do you think there is a connection between quantum computing and artificial intelligence or AI?
Well, not surprisingly, there's a lot of interest now in what happens when we combine together quantum computing and machine learning or artificial intelligence. Now, we're already seeing that AI and machine learning, ML, are having a practical impact. It's changing not just, you know, whether we can drive our autonomous vehicles or recognize a spoken language or play Go, it's also changing the way we do science. And my expectation is that by combining the ideas of artificial intelligence with quantum processing, that will be a more powerful way of understanding quantum systems and how they behave and how we can manipulate and use them. Now, it may be that by using quantum computers, we can outperform the classical computers that are running AI applications now. But we're not really sure about that at all. I don't think we should expect a quantum computer to do a better job on the types of applications that we use machine learning for today. More likely, quantum machine learning, when we combine the two, will have different applications and probably ones that are hard to anticipate now.
Okay, we have time for one more question. This one comes from Mark Weitzman. When is John Preskill's long-awaited book on quantum computation and quantum information coming out?
Well, this is in reference to some lecture notes that resulted from a course I've been teaching at Caltech for a while. Actually, the first time I taught it was 1997, 98, and that was pretty early. There weren't textbooks available at that time on quantum computing. And as I was giving the lectures, I wrote up notes and I put them on my website, and they're still there. They've been updated. Some of them have been updated. So people do have access to the notes. Admittedly, they're not complete, and they still are read. I often hear from people who continue to read them and find them useful. As for when the book will actually be published, I have agreed some time ago that they would be published by Cambridge University Press, but they seem to be infinitely patient with me. I really would like to finish the book at some stage. But in the meantime, you can enjoy what's available in the form of lecture notes on my website, as many people have.
And what's the URL for your website?
Oh, just Google Preskill. There aren't that many of us. Okay. Go to my homepage and there's a link to it there.
All righty. All right. That's it. Thank you, Dr. Preskill, for joining us and for everyone else for joining us. The next conversation in this series will be on Thursday, April 21st. And we'll be talking about both the creative and scientific process with Spiros Mikalakis, a Caltech researcher who was an advisor on the movie Ant-Man, and screenwriter Ed Solomon, who wrote the Bill and Ted movies, among many others. In the meantime, if you're interested in learning more about the bizarre world of quantum physics and want to even attempt to understand things like superposition and entanglement at a deeper level, check out the Caltech Science Exchange. The site provides clear explanations of not just quantum physics, but other topics in science and technology like climate change and COVID-19. Find it at scienceexchange.caltech.edu. Thanks.